Very good morning to the viewers of today's VCM being organized by IBC and CCMIP committee of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. We have galaxy of the panel with us, including chairman of IBC committee and CCMIP committee, and our honorable past president Subodh Agarwal sir, and learned speaker CA Anil Goyal sir. So let me introduce Mr. Advocate Aman Goyal, who would be moderating the whole session. Aman Goyal is a law graduate from one of the most prominent law university of the country, NUJS, National Law University, Kolkata. The Chief Justice of the India is the Chancellor of that university. At present, he is the part of IBC division of one of the most prominent law firm of India, AJB. So with these words, I would request Advocate Aman Goyal for further proceeding. Over to Aman Goyal.
Thank you, sir. A very good morning to everyone. I would like to welcome everyone who's joining from all over the world to the virtual CPE meeting on latest developments in the IBC. It's jointly organized by the Committee on Capital Markets and Investor Protection and the Committee on Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of ICA. Before a brief introduction of the speakers, I would again like to restate the importance that this contemporary topic holds. As some of us might be aware, this topic is so contemporary that almost every other day the law is being clarified and newer judgments on the same are coming. The agenda for today includes two of such contemporary issues, which are pre-packaged insolvency resolution proceedings and insolvency resolution proceedings against personal guarantors. We are very eager to start the deliberation on the issues. However, before that, I would like to welcome all the esteemed panelists, and I would like to begin with a brief introduction. Provide a brief introduction of CA Anil Goyalji, founder and chairman of AAA Insolvency Professionals LLP. Anil sir is one of the first two insolvency professional entity recognized by Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. He was a member of the advisory committee of IPA of ICAI till March 2020, and has been a co-chairman of ASSOCHAM, National Council of Insolvency and Bankruptcy, till March 2021. He has also been a member of the working group established by IBBI for implementation of individual banking bankruptcy in India. He was also a member of the SEBI group as constituted by IBBI for interaction with SEBI, NSE, and BSE for seeking concessions for companies under the insolvency process. Besides that, CA Anil Goyalji is a regular speaker at various forums and webinars on relating to IBC, valuation, and management of stressed assets under SARFAESI and restructuring of debt. With that, I would again like to extend my warm welcome to Anil sir. I would also at the same time like to welcome the office bearers of the two committees of ICAI, Committee on Capital Markets and Investor Protection, and Committee on the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Firstly, I'd like to welcome CA Durgesh Kabraji, who's the Central Council member of ICAI and the chairman of the committee of IBC. He also serves as the vice chairman of the committee of members in industry and business and the Sustainability Reporting Standards Board of ICAI. Besides that, he's also the convener of Center for Audit Quality and a member of the Quality Review Board. Mr. Kabra is a senior member having extensive experience of more than 30 years in company law, corporate restructuring, management advisory, and audit and assurance services. Besides that, he's an avid speaker and expert in the law of insolvency and bankruptcy and has addressed various seminars and conferences on the same. I would like to welcome you, sir. Going forward, I would like to welcome CA Anuj Goyal ji, who's the chairman of the Committee on Capital Markets and Investor Protection, and a Central Council member of ICAI. He's been with the council for 14 years, 3 years in regional council, besides 6 years in the branch level. He has contributed immensely in various capacities, presently as the chairman of the research committee, the oldest committee of ICAI, and the chairman of the Committee on Capital Markets and Investor Protection. He's also the vice chairman of the Corporate Laws and Corporate Governance Committee, along with the exemplary qualification that he holds in terms of the number of degrees and qualifications. I would like to welcome you, sir. Without further ado, could I please request CA Durgesh Kabra ji for his opening address?
Thank you, Aman. It's indeed a pleasure to see a young advocate moderating this wonderful webinar organized by the Committee for Committee on Capital Markets and simultaneously with the Committee on Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of ICAI. At the outset, I also welcome the past president of the ICAI, Subodh Agarwal ji, and the speaker, another speaker, CA Anil Goyal ji. And it's indeed a pleasure to have this joint program with a committee chaired by Anuj Goyal ji. Anuj Goyal ji, a dynamic leader, a never tiring person. Always, you give him any work, he's having so much of energy that he'll continue to do that. So never tiring person has organized this program, and I wish that all the learners today who have joined, all the participants who have joined today, they will be enriched by the knowledge sharing from Subodh Agarwal ji and Anil Goyal ji. In fact, let me tell you, friends, when we talk about the latest development with the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, the two things which are very important, which comes to our mind, is the personal guarantor to the corporate debtors, and the another one is the prepackaged insolvency resolution process. These two have been amended last. The first one was first the corporate debtors, the personal guarantor to corporate debtors came, and then thereafter, very recently, in the month of April, the prepackaged prepackaged insolvency resolution process have been amended and notified. So these are the two important area where the chartered accountants are going to have a lot of opportunities. And let me tell you, friends, the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code is evolving one. We need to learn. The institute is doing a lot of programs, and since this is a contemporary subject, as is told by Aman in his initial address, let me tell you, friends, there are a lot many opportunities available in this. And when you build your capacity into the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, I'm sure that the chartered accountants who are leading the profession of insolvency and bankruptcy are going to get a lot from this. Today, we are around 67%. The chartered accountants are 67% in the total number of IPs. And as far as the total contribution from our side is concerned, the 75% of the resolution plan or resolution process are being done by the chartered accountants across the country. So looking to all these things, where the opportunities can be there for the chartered accountants are the areas of claim consultant, resolution plan maker, supporting services, transaction audit, forensic audit, and there can be many other areas, or even as liquidator, as insolvency resolution professional, interim resolution professionals. So these are the main areas where the chartered accountants can perform a lot. And I'm sure by the deliberation which is going to take place with respect to the pre-packaged insolvency resolution plan and the personal guarantors to the corporate debtors, the members will get enriched from these two stalwarts of the profession. Friends, looking to all these things, what IBC has decided this year that we must have we must update the members of the ICAI who are into the insolvency resolution or who wants to make their career into the insolvency resolution. And therefore, what ICAI has done, ICAI has thought of coming out with the publications. Reading the whole IBC code of around 400 pages becomes sometimes difficult. So we have broken this into 60-70 page publications, one on claim, one on resolution plan, one on CIRP, one on moratorium, one on do's and don'ts, one on pre-packaged, and one on resolution plan. So like that, there are around 8 publications which the IBC is coming, of which 6 publications are going to be released on 1st of July. And beside that, we are also having every month at least 2 case studies discussed, which have been resolved over there at the IBC, IBBI level, or by NCLT, NCLAT, Supreme Court, or wherever it is possible. So we are discussing those case study also. So these are the initiative which has been taken, and we are also updating the members every month through the case law updates that has been issued from month March, April, May, and the June will be recently sent, because at the end of the month we send the whole month's case which have been settled in the IBC, whether it is from Supreme Court or from High Court or from NCLT or NCLAT. So these are the things where the IBC committee is doing a lot of things, and I wish that every members of the institute take benefit of all these things. We are going to launch a certificate course on the insolvency and bankruptcy code also. Most probably we will be launching this with the IBBI, and once it is done, the IBBI gives us relaxation in the condition that it has to be only for the members of ICAI, then we will do with them. Otherwise, we have approved that we will do for our members only this certificate. Because if we want to have the name of IBBI in the course, probably there is some restrictions that you have to do it for the other members also. So which we will be asking them for the relaxation. Otherwise, we have got it approved that it will be only for our members. So that's how we are going to proceed into that. And that will enable to build the capacity of our members, how they can be a part, even if they have not completed of 10 years, how they can be a part of the insolvency resolution process and plan. So with this, I thank Anuj Goyalji for taking lead in drafting and organizing this particular program, and having two stalwarts of the profession, Subodh Agarwalji and Anil Goyalji, who are the very well-known face in this area. And I'm sure that all the members will get benefit out of it. Thank you, Anuji, for planning this program at the right time. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks to everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, Durgesh sir, for the opening remarks. It's great to note the work that the work and publications both that the Committee on Insolvency and Bankruptcy is doing and putting forth. May I please now request Sri Anuj Goyalji, the chairman on the Committee on Capital Markets and Investor Protection, for his opening remarks.
Thank you, Aman Goyalji, the moderator of this very, very important VCM on latest developments in insolvency and bankruptcy code, organized by CCMIP and Committee on Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, headed by my brother, elder brother, Sri Durgesh Kabraji. And I welcome, on behalf of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and Committee on Capital Markets and Investors Protection, and CIBC, our honorable past president of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, my elder brother, and the resource person in today's program, C.A. Subodh Agrawal ji. Very, very big round of applause for C.A. Subodh Agrawal, sir. And of course, we are having C.A. Anil Goyal ji, very prominent professional who is contributing in a great way in the field of insolvency and bankruptcy. We are, of course, having our honorable chairman, Durgesh Kabra ji, who is really trying to see that how we can contribute in a best possible manner in the field of insolvency and bankruptcy, and the chartered accountants who are the best accounting professionals across the globe. I think under the leadership of Durgesh ji are trying their level best to not only serve the trade and industry, but also to serve the nation. I welcome Rita ji, our secretary of CIBC, and Dr. Amit Agarwal ji, secretary of CCMIP, as well as the secretary of the research committee, because these bureaucrats are the pillars of both the committees to really do something very, very good for the profession, for the nation. So very good evening, friends.
We sir, they are the good officers. They are not bureaucrats. Let us not term them the bureaucrats. Bureaucracy is a red tapism in this country. At least we are not suffering with that, so we should not suffer also.
So I will not comment as of now, and I will comment later on after the program is over. And as the politics is a very, very important word, and political science is a subject, in the same way, bureaucrats is a dictionary meaning, and it is meant for the best of the officers, the civil servants of the country. So, and I know Subodh Agrawal ji and Durgesh Kabra ji, a very, very important political leader of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. They are very, very good politicians who are serving the profession like anything. So very good evening, friends. We are having around 3,000 chartered accountants from each and every part of the world in this very, very important virtual CP program organized by Committee on Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code and Committee on Capital Markets and Investors Protection. And I'm quite confident that when we are having the speakers like Subodh Agrawal sir and Anil Goyal ji, all of us will be really benefited out of the deliberations, and will certainly try to contribute in the best possible manner in this very, very important field for the profession and nation, insolvency and bankruptcy. And friends, at the outset, I would like to extend my warm greetings and welcome to all the esteemed members who are present for today's VCM. And I'm quite confident that this revolutionary code, which came into existence for speedy resolution of growing case of insolvency and bankruptcy in India, and the members of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, who are the best accounting professional across the globe, are having the great responsibility on their shoulders to really contribute in the best possible manner for the cause of the trade and industry. And in turn, it would be really good, not only for the profession, but also for the nation. And when we do look forward for the 5 trillion economic target of the Prime Minister Modi, I think this insolvency and bankruptcy code is going to be very, very important, and the role of the Chartered Accountants of India is going to be very, very important. Friends, as rightly remarked by one of the famous philosopher, change is the end result of all true learning. Keeping that in mind, we at ICI regularly thrives to update and educate our esteemed members in the changing times to enhance their professional competency and growth through conducting various knowledge enriching webinars and VCMs on contemporary topics, even in these challenging times of COVID. Friends, as far as the Committee on Capital Markets and Investors Protection is concerned, CCMIP has been entrusted with various responsibilities like providing suggestions on various bills, regulations, notifications, circulars, and other documents relating to capital market for submission to the government, a regulator, initiating research studies in the field of capital market and investors protection, conducting training programs for members and others on matters relating to capital and commodity markets. Friends, the Committee on Capital Market and Investors Protection works in the area promoting investors protection by nurturing capacity and competency development of the members and stakeholders in the capital market. And the committee will be actively working in the area of financial literacy for the development of economy through various initiatives to educate and empower citizens. Committee also works to develop competitive workforce for capital market and corporate through its various learning initiatives like workshops and training programs on capital market and allied areas. One of the allied areas is insolvency and bankruptcy, in which we are now jointly having this virtual CPE program. It conducts two flagship certificate courses, Subodh sir, for professional development of members in the field of forex and treasury management and derivatives. And very recently, Subodh sir, we have launched online certificate courses for, on forex and treasury management and derivatives, specifically for the, designed for the members of the Middle East, for the members of the Gulf countries, because we are quite confident that members who are there in the Gulf countries are very, very keen to contribute in this very, very important field of forex and treasury management and derivatives. And on 1st July, on the Chartered Accountants Day, we are going to launch two very, very important certificate courses. And I'm quite confident with the help of these four certificate courses, our chartered accountants who are the best accounting professionals across the globe, I think we can update their knowledge like anything. We can sharpen their skills, and they can contribute in the best possible manner in this very, very important field for the profession. Recently, one of the very important decisions, Subodh sir, we have taken, our Committee on Capital Markets and Investors Protection, in the very first meeting, we have taken one decision that our chartered accountants, besides being in practice, Subodh sir, if he is a practicing chartered accountant, he's a partner in a chartered accountant firm, he's in full-time practice, then besides being in full-time practice, he can 10 crores income from equity derivatives. And earlier it was not allowed, but now Anil ji and Subodh ji both can 10 crores because they are dealing in insolvency and bankruptcy. A lot of money is there. So they can very well have the investment in the equity derivatives, and they can have the income of 10 crores from equity derivatives, and it is allowed to a practicing chartered accountant. Now our council of the institute has also given the consent. So I'm quite confident that this insolvency and bankruptcy code 2016, which was enacted with an aim to tackle the persistent problem of bad debts affecting Indian financial institutions and trade creditors. The key purpose of the enactment was to consolidate and amend the laws relating to recognition.
All right. So without further ado, I would like to introduce the topic of the second session, which CA Anil Goyalji will address. The topic relates to prepackaged insolvency resolution process, a new opportunity for professionals. And we're very eager to hear Anil sir's remarks on this. So I'd invite Anil sir to build.
Thank you very much, Aman. And you are doing it wonderfully. I believe a young advocate doing this moderation is a delight in itself. And thank you, Anuj Bhai, for this opportunity which you are providing to me. And this is I'm actually, you are my own institute, you are a council member, and you are also a chairman of Committee on Capital Market and Investors Protection. And your active role in promoting education can be seen. My greetings to Durgesh Kabraji also, who is the chairman of Committee on Insolvency and Bankruptcy of ICAI. Also my greetings to CA Jayashara, vice chairman of the Committee of Capital Market, and CA Prakash Sharma, who is the vice chairman of the IBC committee. Thank you very much for this session. I have the dual responsibility now that I have to finish my subject in limited time, and also maybe that I have to take up some questions on both these subjects. That's wonderful. My focus today would be what are the opportunities under this prepackaged insolvency
process?
Yes.
Of course, we know the time is short. But I will request the delegates, we are having around 3,000 delegates, if 15-20 minutes extra, because that lot number of questions are also there. So you take your own time as far as this deliberation is concerned. We'll try to see that how we can rapid fire round of the questions can be there, so that without going in further detail, we can in a rapidly manner, we can answer the queries. So you take your own time as far as this this subject is concerned. And then we will respond to the questions in rapid fire.
Right, right. I think we'll do that. Right. So my focus today would be, Anuj Bhai, to make my professional colleagues who are mostly chartered accountants, to make them understand what kind of opportunities are there and how they can use the prepackaged insolvency resolution process to the benefit of their profession and also to the benefit of all those clients that they are dealing with and having some kind of financial stress in their businesses. That is the focus today, and I would actually not go very detailed manner in the provisions of the, in short, we will call this as PPIRP, the pre-packaged insolvency resolution process, in short, that we will call it as PPIRP, and the existing, the corporate insolvency resolution process, which is applicable to any corporate debtors, that we will call as a CIRP for the conversation today. So my dear professionals, this I will take 1 minute to share my screen so that we, without wasting any further time, we should reach directly to the subject. The subject is very dear to me. In fact, the insolvency entirely is very dear to me. I would even do this little bit of short manner. This okay, so friends, like, I would first of all take you through the what is the need of this PPIRP. As you understand, the CIRP, we have seen the CIRP for the last now 4.5 years, and the CIRP has got some limitations, and some of these limitations I have noted here. One, that the government was actually seeing that this, for most of the MSME, this CIRP was not really resulting into a very big resolution, as the, in most of the MSME, the business more or less depends upon the board of directors or the key managerial personnels. We also call MSME businesses as mom pop business. These are started by families, and control and custody remains with the families, and the board of directors is also more or less having the families. So therefore, we also call these as mom pop companies. The government of India was working for doing something different for MSME. So therefore, it's the government of India started working about a year back regarding doing something different for MSME, because MSME is the backbone of our country for GDP contribution and also for employment generation. Therefore, the first step taken by the government of India was to change the definition of MSME. That was done on 1st of June 2020, where the definition of MSME was changed. So the presently, the definition of MSME is that any company having turnover of up to 250 crore in the last year, and there is a word and, investment in plant and machinery not exceeding 50 crores. So all these companies, first of all, it has to be an incorporated entity. Second condition is that it should be a turnover of 250 crores, less than 250 crores, and investment in plant and machinery up to 50 crores. Then this PPIRP structure or framework would be applicable to this MSME corporate debtor. So this is a special structure for MSME. Second condition, it should be a company. And the third situation, it should be under some financial stress. Then this structure is applicable. So the difficulty that we found in the CIRP in the last 4.5 years was the RP takes over the possession of the company. So there is a disruption in the business. So therefore, no MSME company wanted that their company should go in the hands of RP. And also there was a restriction that the promoters would not be able to participate into the submission of resolution plan. And also it was not liked by the creditors that we should give the company back to the same promoter who caused loss to us. So therefore, first of all, the section 240A was inserted in the IBC, where some concessions were given to MSME corporate debtor. One was that the even if the MSME corporate debtor is NPA or any other so then that would not be considered as an ineligibility under section 29A for participating into the resolution process by the promoters. Second, even if their guarantee is invoked, still they would be eligible to participate. So that was the first thing, that the promoters of MSME corporate debtor would be eligible to participate into the resolution process. Second, the definition of MSME was changed to 50 crores and 50 crores. And third, this special framework for PPIRP was introduced on 4th of April 2021. Such a latest thing. And on 9th of April, everything was completely clear. Regulations were introduced, rules were introduced, and it was ready for filing applications to NCLT. So the biggest change between the CIRP and the PPIRP is that in the PPIRP, there are three differences. One, that the control and custody of the business and assets of the corporate debtor continues to be with the board of directors. The control and custody of the business and the corporate business and the assets of the corporate debtor continues to be with the board of directors. So therefore, the RP is not taking control. Second, the preservation and protection of the assets of the company is the duty of the board of directors during PPIRP. In CIRP, it is the duty of the RP. Third, to continue the company as a going concern is the responsibility of the board of directors during PPIRP, whereas in CIRP, it is the duty of the RP. So very clearly, these three distinctions are very, very significant change. And definitely the more and more MSME corporate debtors would prefer this framework when they are expecting that the financial stress is not kind of solvable by them, or they would not be able, if they are not able to find a resolution of within their own capacity and capability, then they would definitely like to resolve it through the PPIRP. So the first distinction is that the board of directors continues to be in the possession, control, and custody of the business. Number two, the protection and preservation is their duty, and they will keep the company as a going concern. Next is it is not coercive. Normally, the CIRP, we call it as an insolvency attack. When the company is not able to pay its debt, maybe to workers, to operational creditors, to suppliers, to financial creditors, then somebody would give notice to the promoters notice to the company for invoking insolvency law, or somebody will file the application to NCLT invoking insolvency law and will apply for commencement of CIRP. So this is called, we normally called it as an insolvency attack. So the MSME corporate debtors would try to resolve their financial stress by way of taking the shelter under the PPIRP framework. They would approach their financial creditors. They would provide them the information about their financial stress, and they would actually take them along for finding a resolution through PPIRP. Government has made this as mutual, consensual, not coercive. It is cost effective. It is much quicker, and there is no disruption to the business at large. It assures maximum value realization, and ultimately it assures continuation of the business, continuation of the jobs. It preserves jobs, and there is no disruption even if the resolution fails. However, in case of CIRP, if the resolution fails, the company goes into liquidation, whereas in PPIRP, the company doesn't go into liquidation in normal circumstances if the PIRP fails. As I said, that has already been implemented on 9th of April completely. So the to my professional colleagues, who most of them are chartered accountants, I would actually try to explain what are the existing setup or existing options available for managing or for resolving the financial stress of a MSME corporate debtor. The first is the CIRP under the IBC code. Of course, that we have already seen for the last 4.5 years, the RP takes over the company and the promoters are always shying away in getting through the CIRP because they understand then the company will go away from their control and it will become public, it will become stigma, it will lose their credibility, it will be, they would be probably losing control. So that's not preferred because the most of the MSME corporate debtors, the businesses are being run by the board of directors, families. So therefore, the people coming from outside would not be able to offer much value for that business, even if the business is EBITDA positive or business is viable. The second option is, which is court-supervised, is the compromise or arrangement under Section 230 of the Companies Act. And in 230 of the Companies Act, I will come at a later stage why that is also not very popular. And so there are two other out-of-court options. One is that the RBI Prudential Framework for Resolution of Stressed Asset, and the other is the informal understanding between debtors and creditors without having any mediator or without having any court supervision or court order. CIRP, we've already discussed that in most of the CIRP, there are difficulties. There are difficulties of having no cash, no liquidity. The RPs are not able to continue the operations. RP is not able to even protect and preserve the assets. RP is not able to do justice because hardly there is any money. And the committee of creditors feel it is very expensive process because they have to contribute for the CIRP cost, various other reasons. So under Section 230 Companies Act, this schemes require 75% of the voting from all class of creditors, and there can be a separate class of creditors for operational creditors, for even statutory liabilities, for workmen, and therefore even for debentures. So there is a lot of litigation possibilities, and 75% people agreeing for that kind of haircut is also not considered viable, and the banks or financial creditors, they would not agree for haircut with 75% vote, because this is also a kind of a effort with the voting. So while this Section 230 of the Companies Act is very popular for mergers, acquisitions, and amalgamations and demergers, because that's a scheme of arrangement between the shareholders. However, this scheme of arrangement between the creditors is not very popular because the creditors would not give any consent for any kind of haircut. So this scheme is more popular for arrangement between the shareholders, but not very popular for corporate debt restructuring. These challenges between the RBI Prudential Framework is also, like, as per the circular dated 7th of June 2019, there also the banks are required to have an inter-creditors agreement, and the inter-creditors agreement with the 75% of the vote is required. So there are. This is only possible for the RBI monitored financial creditors, and there are many other creditors who are not RBI monitored, like insurance companies, mutual funds, debenture holders, real estate allottees, or offshore creditors. So who are again see outside the RBI control domain. So the such creditors may invoke insolvency, and in the process, the resolution under RBI's prudential framework may be disturbed and it may not be even effective. So this RBI framework is also not really very popular, and it is not being used by the lenders, by the borrowers also. Now the other part, which is the most important in today's discussion, is the restructuring by lenders, by creditors, or one-time settlement proposals. All the professional colleagues would understand the restructuring by the banks, financial institutions, NBFCs, that's what can be done now under the PPIRP. Because the restructuring which is being done today, that has got some limitations. And similarly, the one-time settlement proposals that is being done by the that's being approached by the borrowers, that also can be done through this structure. So presently, there is no formal structure available for restructuring or OTS. Each bank or financial institution, they are doing it according to their own internal policies. And as the RBI doesn't have much control, or there is no uniform policy for restructuring. The general restructuring processes that we have seen is the working capital term loan, funded interest term loan, interest-free term loan, concessional rate of interest, some deferment in repayment period, some moratorium is being granted. So therefore, all this comes along with the recompense clause. In most of the cases, the promoter contribution is also asked. Some kind of additional security is asked. Some fresh funds are being asked by the banks. So these are all the normal features of restructuring proposal. Although there is no restriction on banks giving additional funds, but banks normally shy away from giving additional funds for a company which is already under stress. There is no committee for all the lenders. Internal committee of each bank will take separate decision. It is not possible that all the banks can take a collective decision. And if it is possible, then there is no time limit, then there is no structured forum, and there is no official way of calling the meetings or discussing in the meetings or circulating the minutes. The most important is that when we go for OTS or when we go for restructuring, Section 53 of the IBC is not applicable. Section 53 of the IBC is the major benefit of PPIRP framework, because see, the company's assets would be valued and the liabilities would be categorized under the various categories of Section 53, like secured creditors, workmen, employees, unsecured financial creditors, and then the operational creditors, suppliers, government and statutory liabilities. All this is categorized under PPIRP, and then there is a priority that if the total working capital or total funds available or total assets having a value of say 100 crores available with the company, and if the 100 crore will be allocated according to the priority under Section 53, and wherever 100 crore finishes, and after that any other category would not be entitled to any amount after the resolution plan is approved. So the this is the benefit of PPIRP, which benefit is not available under the normal restructuring or OTS, which is being done by the banks. The banks are shying away from doing restructuring because there is no assessment of the market value of the company, whereas in PPIRP, it would be possible. The time taken, it depends upon the incumbent in charge in the banks or the banks on pace. The banks are also not comfortable that whatever the promoter says that they should agree. In PPIRP, they have an option of calling resolution plans from public at large. So they feel more comfortable. They try to understand what is the value of the company. In the restructuring, there is no order from any court, which becomes binding on the other creditors. And in most of the restructuring cases, in case the banks are not agreeing to what the borrowers are offering, then the banks may take IBC action or may invoke SARFAESI. So these are all the kind of reasons why the PPIRP would be more useful. When I say that a normal restructuring or OTS proposals all will go through PPIRP, I am not shying away and saying that now once this framework gets popularity amongst the lenders, then whenever any of your client will go to bank for restructuring or for one-time settlement, the bank will advise you, bank will advise the your client to go through the PPIRP structure. Because like when there is a structure available which is uniform and which is court supervised, no bank will like to take any kind of risk of accepting something or some bigger haircut or smaller haircut and without having any justification. So this is the PPIRP that we are going to discuss. How can you first of all convince in what circumstances this PPIRP would better for your clients? So let me try to give you a perspective, like who are the eligible companies? Who are the eligible companies for the PPIRP? So I would say I'll just go back to the slide. Sorry. Garam Pani. So first of all, the company has to be a incorporated entity. Maybe it's an LLP or it's a company. Secondly, it has to be a MSME. A registration is also required. Although there are ways that in case the registration is not there, still we can go ahead. Third condition is that the company must be having a default of at least 10 lakhs of rupees, and that default can be with any, maybe it is with the borrower, maybe lenders, maybe operational creditors, maybe government liabilities, any kind of default of more than 10 lakhs of rupees is the condition. Then is the corporate debtor has not undergone any PIRP in the last three years. So that's not applicable because it is only about 3 months that it has started. There should not be any CIRP going on. There should not be any liquidation going on. And the corporate debtor should be eligible to submit a resolution plan because the corporate debtor may not be a willful, should not be a willful defaulter, should not be convicted for offenses punishable with an imprisonment and prohibited by SEBI from trading in securities. The definition I've already discussed. However, there are two, three important things that I have to discuss with you that when we calculate the investment in plant and machinery, we have to see the new procedure. The new procedure is that the investment in plant and machinery would be picked up by the website of MSME Ministry, which is called Udyan Registration Portal, and it will be picked up from your income tax return. In income tax return, we submit our fill the figures of plant and machinery, and that is the WDV that we fill in. There is no column of filling the gross value. So that is the value of the plant and machinery that we will pick up. The plant and machinery definition as per the income tax law is that it includes everything other than land, building and furniture. Land, building and furniture, it will pick up everything like plant and machinery, equipment, electrical fittings, vehicles, cars, trucks, buses, ships, airplanes, softwares and books of the profession. Everything comes under the plant and machinery, and the value for eligibility of a company as MSME, the investment in plant and machinery, the should not be more than 50 crores when we pick up the figure from the Income Tax Act, from the Income Tax Portal, which is the WDV. That means the investment in plant and machinery should be less than 50 crores as WDV, not the gross value. And the other circular or section of the MSME Act is that the some kind of plant and machinery is excluded from this 50 crores. That is the cost of pollution control, research and development, industrial safety devices, and some kind of jobs, jigs, molds are also excluded. So when we talk about the turnover also would be taken from the GST portal and the income tax portal, and the turnover would exclude export turnover. As an illustration, in case a company is doing a turnover of say 1000 crore and it has the plant and machinery of less than 50 crores of WDV, And the total 1,000 crore includes 800 crores of export and 200 crores of domestic turnover. Still, the company is an MSME. As I'm saying that the there are new norms for registration, and every entrepreneur is required to register the MSME entity, and the last date is 1st of July 2021. Till that date, everyone is supposed to provide the fresh information to the registration portal, which will include the business profile and the turnover as per the last income tax return, as per the last GST return, and the investment in plant machinery as per the last the income tax return. So everyone is supposed to file the updated information on Udyam registration portal. That is, then the registration number would be granted. It's an online application. So when we talk about this pre-packaged insolvency resolution process, so my friends, you would try to see which one of your client is undergoing financial stress and is not able to pay its debts, and the banks or the lenders are trying to take some actions either under IBC or under SARFAESI, then you can even ask him to go through the PPIRP, or anyone who is trying to put in some money and revive the business, then you also can ask him that in case you are putting some additional money by selling, by sale of your assets, then you should go through the OTS as under PPIRP framework. Now, other greater role that this PPIRP will go through is the when there is a MSME corporate debtor is in interesting in some kind of partnership for getting some funds to resolve the financial stress, or some investor or some partner in the company. So in these circumstances also, because you might have seen in most of the undertakings, the business is viable, there is hardly any possibilities of people coming and joining that company as partner or as an investor or as a shareholder, because the company is having some kind of liabilities which nobody would like to share, past liabilities, past non-compliances, past statutory liabilities, past workman liabilities. So nobody is interested in coming and joining these companies as partner, investor, or shareholders unless the past liabilities are freezed. So this is also a very big tool that we can even invite partners, investors, and shareholders in our company, while we will give them a clean slate, and all the liabilities of the past, all the non-compliances of the past, all criminal liabilities of the past would be completely freezed, and that would be restricted to the old management. It will not be passed on to the new management, new directors, new shareholders, new investors, or new partners. So this is the most important. Whenever we find an opportunity of having some partner or some investor into MSME corporate data, it should be done through PPIRP if the company has any stress. However, if the company is completely compliant, completely solvent, then there is no need of this. Then even otherwise, the takeovers or participations happens through the other way of agreements. So the entire structure of PPIRP is bifurcated into four segments: phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four, A, B, C, D. So the first phase is preparation and application, and the second phase is the admission of the application or rejection by the NCLT. Phase C is the insolvency process and submission of the resolution plan, and phase D is the approval of the resolution plan by NCLT. So these phases are carefully designed by us. So now let us understand that you got a client who actually is fitting into this framework. Then in that case, what is required from your side as a consultant? So the firstly that you actually have to become a consultant for that company, and as a consultant, what are you supposed to do? That's what I'm going to tell. First part is that you should identify a client who actually is fitting into the requirements of PPIRP. Number one, it should be a company, it should be MSME, it should have some financial stress, and And the other things are that the company is interested in some kind of restructuring, some kind of OTS, or the company is interested in some kind of partners which is coming from outside, and or some investors or some shareholders who are coming from outside, but they are shying away because they are not getting the clean slate. They are shying away because they are scared of the past liabilities, bank liabilities, operational creditors, market liabilities, statutory liabilities, and also workman liabilities, and also the criminal liabilities, so or the non-compliance liabilities. So any things of this, in case you find any person who's got all this, but still some investor is interested in coming because the business is viable as a loan, the business is only suffering from higher debt, the business is only suffering from more liabilities, the business is only suffering from some non-compliances, some raids, some tax raids, some GST raids. So all these things can be handled by just invoking PPIRP. So once you have decided, first of all, that you have found a MSME corporate debtor having a financial stress. Second, that you have found he is willing. He is willing to go through a restructuring with the lenders. He is willing to go through an OTS with the lenders. He is having, or he has identified a person who is ready to invest, who is ready to become partner. Then let us understand what you want to do. Now, how to start this PPIRP? You need to become a consultant. You need to become a consultant to your client. You need to advise him how this PPIRP functions, how the base resolution plan can be prepared, what kind of haircuts that you actually can propose to the lenders. So the first is the, as I said, that the identification and the opportunity that we've gone through. Now this thing, now this other is that let us try to prepare a base resolution plan. So for preparing a base resolution plan, we need a complete list of creditors of the company, including the financial creditor, secured creditor, unsecured creditor, operational creditor, statutory liabilities, contingent liabilities. So everything that you actually will seek from the client, and when you have this information, then you would also get the information about the assets or the value of the business as a running concern. So if you find that the assets are less than the liabilities, then PPIRP is most suitable. But if you find that the assets, the market value of the assets are actually much, much more or equal to the liabilities, then PPIRP will not help. And that particular company is also not considered to be under the financial stress. So the company doesn't have assets equivalent to the liabilities. So now in case the company has an asset of 50 crores against the liabilities of 100 crore, the focus of the framework is that the asset would, the total business of the company would be resolved considering 50 crore as the asset, and the creditors will have to satisfy themselves within the 50 crores, even if their claim is 100 crore. So once this 50 crore is allocated to them as per the priority and the resolution plan is approved by the NCLT, the rest of the 50 crores would be completely extinguished from your balance sheet, and they would have no entitlement to get this company or claim this company from the corporate debtor, MSME corporate debtor. So when you are a consultant to this company, you need to prepare the assets liability list, and then you have to see whether there is a stress or not, and whether the company is solvent or insolvent. If the company is insolvent, that means that it doesn't have the assets equivalent to the liabilities, then you actually have to structure in what manner the resolution plan can be prepared. What is the resolution of your company? Is this resolution found only in the haircut? In case we reduce our liabilities, if the business is viable, what is the EBITDA of the business? This EBITDA can support or service what kind of debt? That's the next status of the discussions. And based on this, you can prepare a resolution plan which will state the present profile of the company, present profile of the debt or the liabilities, present value of the assets, and then how would you resolve the stress of the company. Now the stress of the company can be resolved by way of seeking the some haircut from the financial creditors only. Second option, you can actually find the resolution by seeking the haircut from all kinds of creditors. You can find the resolution in selling some of the properties of the company, and negotiating with the financial creditors, and you can find a resolution where there is no haircut proposed for operational creditors, but the only haircut proposed is to financial creditors. And you can also find a resolution where your tax liabilities or GST liabilities would be completely extinguished because the assets are not available and the statutory the liabilities are not supposed to be paid in case the assets are not sufficient and the has finished before even the priority of statutory creditors starts. So at this level, you need to discuss with the client, you need to understand the PPIRP provisions, or you will need to engage with the person or an insolvency professional or a lawyer who understands PPIRP. So as a consultant, you are advising your company, and that company will try to find out what is the best solution. And in case their liability can be reduced and they can still continue the company with some kind of sacrifice from their side as promoters also. So now once the base resolution plan is prepared, then you can start informal negotiations, informal meetings with your lenders, and the lenders may get convinced that this is the reason that you are coming for PPIRP. And after that, you need to pass a resolution in the board meeting and declaration, and also special resolution in the meeting of members, shareholders. And then there are some other documents that need to be prepared. And then as a corporate debtor, you will invoke the provisions of PPIRP and will start the official process of PPIRP from the date of declaration by majority of directors. Thereafter, you would be entitled to call for official meetings of your lenders. All the financial creditors, secured or unsecured, will become your committee of creditors or your creditors, and you will be calling a meeting, official meetings, through a notice of minimum 5 days. And in that meeting, your resolution plan, your base resolution plan, your verification of your MSME status, the kind of projections that you have made in the base resolution plan, everything would be discussed. And the lenders will take a decision that the PPIRP may be started, because if they would not try to find out the solution right now, then they may not actually survive. Then they may not get the recovery. Then somebody might even start CIRP, or somebody might even start SERFACE. So these are the circumstances that you actually have to call the meetings, or within 90 days, the banks will agree. Banks will provide their consent. Yes, the PPIRP can be started. Once the banks take a decision, then the banks will try to appoint an insolvency professional as RP on your company, and then the application would be prepared for submission to NCLT. In that application, RP will also submit some reports. So the application would be admitted by the NCLT in a much faster way, because there will not be any opposition, because it's already agreed by the financial creditors, already agreed by the promoters, and technically the law has provided only 14 days time, but let us assume that the NCLT will take 1 or 2 months in giving you the order for commencement of PPIRP. So this kind of communication would continue, and this process would actually continue for say about 90 days from the date of declaration by the board of directors in their meeting. So this 90 days would start, which is called pre-packaged insolvency resolution process. In this process of 90 days, a lot of things would be done, and this is what I am going to explain to you in a minute. I will have to just take a gap of one only.
Right. Anil sir will be resuming shortly. We request you to wait for a minute. Thank you.
So thank you, and I would restart as from the same where we says that now the banks have agreed and banks have given the consent that yes, this PPIRP can be started. They are convinced about the base resolution plan in principle, and they may even negotiate at that time. No, this is a little different and we need some different way. So this all, then finally the bank will appoint an RP. So who would be an insolvency professional? So there are two different things that I'm talking about. One is the chartered accountant who understand restructuring and who understand one-time settlement, who understand financial stress and assets and liabilities. He can become a consultant to the corporate debtor for doing this complete process. And the other is an RP who would be appointed as RP by the financial creditors, because that choice would be for the financial creditor that he may they may appoint somebody who is more independent and who they select. And it is hardly possible that they would go through an RP who is closer to the corporate debtor. So there are two separate assignments that I'm talking about. So each and every chartered accountant who understands restructuring and OTS can actually get benefit out of this framework and convince. And as far as this, the chartered accountant even can also do this jointly with some insolvency professionals who have the expertise of PPIRP. So they can also engage them for the consultation, and they mostly they would try to find a resolution for the corporate debtor. The consultant will have to prepare is the list of claims and declarations under section. So all this is a part of the process. I'm trying to say that this will take too much of time. And as far as the contents of the base resolution plan is concerned, it's primarily whatever restructuring proposal that you've been always preparing, it will be nothing beyond that. The preparation I have already explained that the eligibility that we have to see, all this is completely done. In this particular case, there is slightly different. The RP would be appointed, the resolution professional will be appointed for two stages. The first stage is which is called pre-PPIRP stage, and then there will be a stage which is called the RP in the PPIRP process. And then there will be a third possibility also that if during this PPIRP, the creditors ask the RP to take control and custody by invoking section 54J, then the RP would be doing almost the same work as the RP in the case of CIRP. So the RP will quote three kind of fees. One, for the pre-PIRP period. Two, for the PIRP period. Three, for the PIRP period in the eventuality that the control is taken by the RP. So the RP is now selected by the financial creditors, and after this, an application will be submitted along with the report of the RP to NCLT. Apparently, there will not be any opposition because the promoters are already doing it themselves after passing resolutions in the meeting of board of directors and in the meeting of the members. So there will not be any kind of opposition. So this may not be an adversarial proceedings. So it will be only a kind of the NCLT will look into the documents, eligibility, their default, and the resolutions and the approvals, and then they will pass the order commencing CIRP. I'm not sure there will be any opposition, and even the law of natural justice, where the notice is required to be given to all parties, also probably may be skipped in this case because the other party is already submitting. Also, both the parties are already agreeing to a process, so there would not be any requirement of even giving notices to other party. So then the NCLT will pass an order. So RP is appointed by the order of the NCLT, and the process of 120 days start from the appointment of RP. So the pre-PIRP period is also 90 days, and that period is 90 days from the start of the declaration by Board of Directors. After the declaration of the Board of Directors, within 90 days, the banks will say either no or yes. And in case in the first 90 days, the bank says that we are not convinced about your resolution plan, so we need more time. So then the corporate debtor, MSME corporate debtor, can again renew the declaration by the Board of Directors, and can another 90 days can start and can call for the meetings of the bankers for discussions on the modified resolution plan. So now this is the pre-PIRP and now the PIRP. Now the PIRP period starts, the RP is appointed, and the RP has all the duties regarding any other RP except for the three duties. So in this case, the RP doesn't have three duties. One, to keep the company as a going concern. Number two, to preserve and protect the assets of the corporate debtor. And number three, to take control and custody of all the businesses and assets of the corporate debtor. These three duties are not there. All other duties are same, but these three duties are absolutely missing out of it. So this is where the company will continue to run by the board of directors. They would do the business. They would maintain their own bank account. They will operate their own bank account. They would, their customers will not even come to know. And even the employees also would not come to know, because the process doesn't have any, this process doesn't have any public notice in the newspaper. The only notice which is required to be given is to the creditors, because the creditors have to become part of the process. So there is no stigma. So the business continues to, as you understand, all my dear professional friends, that whenever a company goes for restructuring or OTS, and your business associates never come to know, except that your creditors, because they only would come to know to whom you are approaching for restructuring or one-time settlement. So this is the same structure, and the company continues. Nobody would come to know. And once this company goes through the NCLT process, then the company's liabilities are crystallized closer to the assets. The liabilities are crystallized, which is a sustainable debt. And the company can, and the outsiders can come and join the company without any fear. The company will become a clean slate. And at that particular clean slate, the business can be run in a much more beneficial and in a free manner. The duties of the RPs are almost the same. As I said, the three duties are not there. The fee I've already discussed, that in this case, the cost of this PPIRP has to be borne by the company. In CIRP, if the company doesn't have any funds, then the cost is supposed to be borne by the COC members, financial creditors. In PPIRP, the cost is to be borne by the company. So to maintain, so there, as I said, that the three kinds of fees that the RP will have to, as far as the consultant fee is concerned, the consultant, of course, the company will keep a consultant, company will keep paying you your fees. The fees of the RP and the process cost, that has to be borne by the company. And for that, it is provided in the law that the company will open a bank account, which will be operated by the RP, and company will deposit appropriate funds based on the estimate prepared by the RP and the COC regarding the total cost. And RP will disburse the payment to himself or to other professionals from that bank account. RP is not required to again go back and beg the fee from the same promoters against whom he's working for the process. So the cost is less than the CIRP because the total period of PPIRP is only 120 days. Litigation would be much lesser. The claims are not supposed to be invited. There will not be any public notice in the newspaper. The list of claims will be submitted by the corporate debtor. Those claims only are supposed to be confirmed by the RP, directly reaching out to the creditors. So this, the fee, as I said, the fee would be paid by the corporate debtor, three kinds of fee, one pre-PIRP, during PIRP, and then in the eventuality where the company is taken over by the RP, those are the three kinds of fees. So the pre-packaged insolvency, and I think that then I will have to just, now the application is filed to NCLT and there is a fee of 15,000 rupees. There is form one in the rules and that application will go and the NCLT would actually do it in much faster manner. So that once the NCLT is done, so I think this is what admission is already, we've already explained that the NCLT admits the so this is the timeline for the PPIRP. So we have assumed that there are two and there are two or three, one process, the pre-PIRP process, and the other is PIRP process. So all these sections that I have given here provides for some kind of duties to be done by the RP within a stipulated timeline. So based on this timeline, we actually have concluded that the first process, which is the engagement, which is pre-PIRP process, would run into 90 days. Then the second process, which is PIRP process, that also would be run into 120 days. And therefore, the total, when this PIRP would start, and there are a lot of things which is supposed to be done by the RP within very, very quick manner. And finally, the entire period would be 240 days. 240 days would be the total period in case everything goes well. That's what is the total PPIRP period. So what is supposed to be done in this PPIRP? So first is the moratorium would be available to all those companies where the order has been passed by the NCLT for PPIRP. Since the company is, since the management is under with the board of directors, so the only one clause of section 14 is not applicable, that is subsection 2 regarding the essential services. Otherwise, all kinds of moratoriums are available to companies under PPIRP. The duties of the RP is almost the same, as I said a number of times, that the three duties and the powers are also the same as the CIRP. There is no difference in the powers. So the difference, I think I would like to say something on the difference between the CIRP and PPIRP. So the PPIRP is with the consent of the promoters, shareholders, directors, and the financial creditors, whereas the CIRP, it is a litigation. So there will be least litigation in PPIRP. So this is a mix of judicial and consensual process. It is mutual, also it is judicial. So there will be a stamp on the process, and that is the approval of the resolution plan. the management and control remains with the corporate debtor, unlike CIRP. The company, the board of directors will have the first right to submit a resolution plan. They would have the first right to submit resolution plan. And even if the resolution plans are invited from the public at large, still the directors, board of directors, company, they would have the right to improve their resolution plan so that it becomes the best resolution plan after noticing the amounts or conditions offered by the public at large. So even if the resolutions are called from the public at large, the promoters would still be given an opportunity to improve their offer, and the committee of creditors will assure that if they give the final resolution plan, which is better than the resolution plan offered by the public, so the company will go back to the same promoters in most probabilities. This is a quicker process. It is only for 120 days after the NCLT order. There is no concept of IRP. The RP is directly appointed as RP. The consent of the financial creditors for appointment of RP is required. So there is no change. There is no change required from IRP to RP. However, the COCs still have the power to change the RP within the 90 days, which probably nobody would do because they have appointed themselves. So there will not be any requirement of change of the RP. So that time also would be saved. Once the PIRP application is filed, thereafter no other application can be filed as CIRP and no SARFAESI action can be taken against the company. Unlike CIRP, if the CIRP fails, the company goes into liquidation, but in case the PIRP fails, the company continues to run its business as usual, as normal. The company doesn't go to liquidation. No claims are invited from the public, but the list of claimants is filed by the company itself, including all the statutory claims, including all the contingent claims, and the RP is only supposed to confirm from those creditors. RP will not run the company, only the board of directors will run the company. RP will supervise the running. RP may ask for some MIS, may ask for some financial information and provide the information to the creditors. So there are provisions and for penalties and prosecution for wrongful declaration of particulars of claimants. The public announcement is not to be done in the newspaper. As I said, the public announcement will be done to all the creditors and information utility and the website of the corporate debtor, if any. So as regard the list of claims is concerned, I've already said that the list of claims are supposed to be filed. The duties of the promoters and directors, I've already said that they would continue to run the company, they would continue to preserve and protect the company. So all those duties of the board of directors continues to be the same. Committee of creditors will be constituted, and the role of the committee of creditors is the same as in the CIRP. And they would take the decision, pass the resolution plan. They would even see if the company is doing some fraudulent business during PIRP, then they can take a decision that the business may be taken over by the RP, and they would supervise it. There is also a concept of authorized representative as we have it in CIRP, because in case there is any class of creditors which are having more than 10 members, then those 10 members would be represented on the committee of creditors by way of an authorized representative. And the selection of authorized representative would also be done by the banks before the application is submitted to NCLT. See, this is what is the one of the job of the RP during pre-PIRP process, because he has to see the creditors, he has to see the class of creditor, he has to appoint an authorized representative for each class of creditor, and the selection process has to be done by the RP during pre-PIRP assignment. Now, resolution. What kind of resolution would be required? So I have to just ask the moderator, Advocate Aman, what kind of time that we have now for concluding this part before we go on to the question answers?
Sir, we can continue for another 15 minutes, then can we can take question and answer.
कितना कॉस्टिंग का एस्टिमेशन
सर जस्ट म्यूटेड I think I'll come again. Yeah. Yes. So I think the message was that we can continue for another 10 to 15 minutes, perhaps, before moving into questions. Would that be fine, sir?
Absolutely fine. So I will try to finish it within 10 to 15 minutes, because the next subject that I'm going to discuss is very, very important. And that actually will give a lot of clarity to most of my professional friends who are chartered accountants, I understand. So now I'm only discussing, not reading through the slides, but I take only kind of a clue from my slides, and I take my own process of making understanding developed. See, one situation is the base resolution plan. Base resolution plan has to be submitted by the company, board of directors, promoters. And that base resolution plan will propose what the company can offer, how the company can offer, and why the creditors should accept it, how that resolution plan, if implemented, would resolve the financial stress of the company, in how many years and in what manner, whether there will be any partner added, whether there will be any upfront payment, whether there will be any sale of asset, whether there will be any collaboration, whether there will be any hiving of the business, any kind of whatever is proposed in the base resolution plan from the promoter side, that is a base resolution plan. This is called base resolution plan. And base resolution plan is one where we can have two possibilities. One possibility is that the haircut is only offered to financial creditors, maybe secured or unsecured, who are the part of the committee of creditors. And if there is no haircut offered to operational creditors, which includes workmen, employees, suppliers of goods and services, statutory liabilities. If there is no haircut proposed in the base resolution plan, then the committee of creditors has an option to accept the resolution plan, base resolution plan, without inviting resolution plans from public at large. They have an option. However, it is not mandatory on them. Even in some cases where no haircut is offered to operational creditors, only some reliefs and concessions are proposed to financial creditors, they may say that we are not able to decide unless we have comparison of what public is offering to give it to us. In that case also, they can invite resolution plans from public. One scenario that no resolution plan is invited from public, then the financial creditors can accept base resolution plan, and that base resolution plan can be submitted to NCLT for approval. The matter closes, the PIRP closes, successful if the resolution plan is approved by the NCLT, very successful. So whatever is being proposed as modification or as some reliefs and concessions from the financial creditors, that is approved. And the company continues as earlier with the reduced liability, with modified liability, and with the, which is sustainable financial debt. Second eventuality, that the committee of creditors is not convinced that we should accept your resolution plan without having a comparison of what public is offering to us, then they can say to the RP that, RP sir, please invite resolution plans from public at large. Then the RP is under obligation to invite for resolution plans from public at large. RP will prepare invitation for resolution plans. RP will publish this invitation on the website of the corporate debtor, website of IBBI, and as decided by the committee of creditors otherwise, detailed IFRP will be prepared, and the detailed evaluation matrix would also be prepared. The evaluation matrix will also have one parameter, which is called significantly better resolution plan. So when all this is being done, one, the law says that the priority would be given to the promoters to take back the company. priority would be given to the promoters to improve their resolution plan if a better resolution plan comes from the public at large. There was an apprehension when the law was being made that in such cases, the promoters will always start from one in case they think that the value of the company is 10. They will wait till the time the public at large will come and offer five. And if the company public at large will come and offer five, then they will go to six and they will take away the company with six as an offer while the value of the company is 10. This was an apprehension. So this concept of significantly better resolution plan was added in the act. Now the significantly better resolution plan is again a criteria which will be decided by the committee of creditors that if a resolution plan which is received from public at large is better than the base resolution plan by this percentage or by this priority or by this factor, then the promoters will lose the opportunity of modifying the resolution plan or improving the resolution plan, and the company will go to the person who has submitted the significantly better resolution plan. So the concept, I'm again saying, we have now one, the base resolution plan. Second is the significantly better resolution plan. The significantly better resolution plan will be measured based on the evaluation metrics. Evaluation metrics will be decided by the committee of creditors, and the parameters on which the evaluation would be done, that also would be decided by the committee of creditors. If any resolution plan is received from the public at large, which is significantly better than the base resolution plan, then the promoters would not be given the opportunity to improve their resolution plan, and they will not get the opportunity to get the company back, and the company would be given to the person who has submitted the significantly better resolution plan. Third scenario. The resolution plan is invited from the public at large and there are multiple people who submitted the resolution plan. Again, all those resolution plans will be negotiated, and the finally, after the negotiation, all these resolution plan will be measured on the evaluation metrics, and whatever resolution plan gets the best score based on the evaluation metrics, which is decided by the committee of creditors, that resolution plan is called the best resolution plan. Now, after discussing this, we have three things. Base resolution plan, and there is no significantly better resolution plan now, because had there been a significantly better resolution plan, then that would have been accepted by the committee of creditors without giving an opportunity to the promoters to improve their base resolution plan. So first scenario was there is a base resolution plan and there is a significantly better resolution plan, and the significantly better resolution plan will be approved by the committee of creditors, and that resolution plan will be sent to NCLT. Another scenario, that we have a base resolution plan, there is no significantly better resolution plan, but there is a best resolution plan because there are four or five people submitted their resolution plan, and after negotiation, there is the best resolution plan. Now that best resolution plan and the base resolution plan would compete with each other on a platform called Swiss challenge, although this Swiss challenge is not used in the code or in the rules, but it is a kind of Swiss challenge where will all the factors where the improvement can be done on the resolution plan that would be put on a format and against the scores that each one has, and everyone will be given an opportunity to improve on all the factors. So when they would improve, and again, the new scores would be calculated, and anyone who is having a lower score would have an opportunity again to submit a modified resolution plan. So this process will continue for about 48 hours. This is called Swiss challenge competition. And after the Swiss challenge, whatever would be the best resolution plan, that best resolution plan would be voted upon by the committee of creditors. And if 66% vote is given to that resolution plan, that would be considered passed by the committee of creditors, and that would be submitted by the RP to NCLT for approval. So NCLT will look into the conditions, all the compliances, and approve the resolution plan. The resolution plan is almost the same as we see in CIRP. All those mandatory conditions are mandatory contents are required. as we have seen in the resolution plans of CIRP, protection of operational creditors, the concept of dissenting creditors, the allocation of resources according to Section 30, Subsection 4, considering the security and the priority. All those concepts are available. And again, the concept of providing performance security is also there. And there is a tick size. Tick size is again one concept which is introduced in PPIRP structure, which is called the minimum improvement required in each bidding cycle. So in each bidding round, there is a minimum amount which is required to be improved. That is called tick size. That also has to be approved by the committee of creditors. And that would be provided in the evaluation matrix. So then there is a concept of, like, in case during this PPIRP, the committee of creditors think that the affairs of the corporate debtor have been conducted in a fraudulent manner, or there is a gross mismanagement of the affairs during this PIRP, then the committee of creditors can pass a resolution with 66% voting and can resolve that the management of the company be taken over by the RP. So that application will be submitted to NCLT. NCLT will pass an order urgently, and the RP will take control and custody of the business. So then thereafter, the RP would be responsible for control and custody of the business and assets, would be responsible for keeping the company as a going concern, would be responsible for preserving and protecting the assets of the corporate debtor. So that's a concept of taking over the management. And in case the management is taken over, and thereafter, no resolution plan is approved by the committee of creditors, then in this circumstances, the company goes into liquidation. Then in this is the only one circumstance that the company goes into liquidation, or in case the resolution plan is approved and it is not accepted by the NCLT, then also it goes into liquidation. Then I say the section, there are two new sections inserted, section 67A, and which says that there'll be a penalty of 1 lakh to 1 crore in case the officer of the committee, officer of the corporate debtor manages the affairs with the intent to defraud creditors. Then we also can discuss approval of the NCLT. So that would be a normal process. So we actually can base resolution plan we have discussed, significantly better resolution plan we have discussed, best resolution plan that we've discussed. So resolution is approved, and after the approval of the resolution plan, it will be binding as in the case of CIRP. And the other conditions, this is what probably we have. So one important part is that we can say the PPIRP also can be terminated in case the committee of creditors resolve by way of voting of 66% that there is nothing going to happen in this company, no PIRP can be, no resolution plan is going to be successful. They can pass a resolution, then they can terminate the PPIRP, and the company would continue to be run as by the promoter as earlier. So the termination order can also be passed by the adjudicating authority to terminate the PPIRP. There is a concept called that the PPIRP, the PPIRP should be voted in CIRP, 66% vote. The company must be eligible for CIRP by the default amount, etc. When the RP will intimate the decision of the committee of creditors to NCLT, NCLT will pass an order within 30 days to terminate PIRP and to initiate CIRP. RP shall be appointed as IRP in that CIRP process, and the all that PIRP cost shall become the CIRP cost. So this is the conversion of the PIRP into CIRP. I would say that valuation is required to be done in PPIRP also. Two registered valuers are required to value the assets. There is no concept of third registered valuer to be appointed. So the law has given 14 forms. For everything, there is a form. P1 to P14, and most of the things are supposed to be done by the in this forms itself. I think Aman, I would like to say that this, we should finish it now, and we should see some questions are there. I have also kind of out of my experiences, there may be some questions that I would answer, like the apprehension of the lenders, why the bankers will accept such kind of proposals. So these are some of the things that we can talk about when the questions come from the public.
Amanji, I suggest you can take the questions.
Yes. I also feel that there might be some overlap in the questions. So I'll just quickly.
Yeah.
So anyone reading the question?
Amanji, yes, I am reading the question. So, yes. So this is a question from CA. Nagesh Babu ji from Hyderabad. During the course of PPIRP, is any financial creditor permitted to settle his dues by way of one-time settlement?
There is no proposal for one-time settlement in this PPIRP. However, In case every debt is settled and then all the creditors collectively can resolve that the PPIRP may be terminated. And that is the only way that we have. Otherwise, once the PPIRP starts, then there is no option with any financial creditor to individually settle and take the payment during PPIRP. Because that, in case that is done, then probably the PPIRP will be terminated.
There is another question by Dinesh Mundadaji from Pune. A prepackaged insolvency resolution process is nothing but a one-time settlement with the banker. And he asks if he's right in understanding that.
So I think I said there are multiple ways that the PPIRP can be used. One of the eventualities that the promoters are interested in doing one-time settlement, and they can actually use this PPIRP framework for an effective one-time settlement, because that would not be only settlement with the financial creditor, that would be settlement with the operational creditors and statutory liabilities also. However, the PPIRP is presently made, the intention of the legislature is to make PPIRP for restructuring, for even bringing investment in MSME, running in MSME, bringing partners into the running MSME, giving them clean slate when somebody wants to enter into existing business, so that the past obligations are not transferred to the new management.
Right. This is a question from C. Rajinder Kumar Jain from Chandigarh. Does the Lalit Kumar judgment change the position and allows for application, a CIRP application against a personal guarantor to be filed in NCLT, even if the CIRP is not already on?
No, there is no change in that scenario. My friend Subodh Agarwal ji has deliberated on the personal insolvency of personal guarantors to corporate debtors. So it's very clear to me that the personal guarantor's insolvency can be started as per the law. What Lalit Kumar Jain versus Union of India has said, that this particular law, the way it has been invoked, is constitutionally correct, and there is no problem in continuing with the insolvency of personal guarantors individually by a class of individuals. If the company's CIRP is not going on, then the personal insolvency of a grantor to a corporate debtor can also be started, but the jurisdiction would be DRT in that case. The jurisdiction would not be NCLT. However, once the application is filed to DRT, thereafter the corporate debtor also goes into insolvency, then all those applications would be transferred to NCLT, the same bench where the proceedings of insolvency of that corporate debtor is going on. So I think, Aman, this was the question?
Yes, yes, exactly. This was indeed the question. Just one sec. Yeah, a couple of questions have been repeated almost, so I'm skipping those questions. Can a petition be filed against personal guarantor if debtor is an individual or partnership firm? And if yes, who is the adjudicating authority?
No, it all depends upon the debtor. It's not a question of debtor. The insolvency of an individual can be started, number one, in case he is a personal guarantor to a corporate debtor. If he is a personal guarantor to a corporate debtor, then only the insolvency can be started. So the condition is that he has provided a personal guarantee to a loan which is being given to a corporate debtor. Number two, the corporate debtor has defaulted. Number three, the demand, the personal guarantee has been invoked. Number four, he has not been able to make payment as guaranteed by him. Then the insolvency of the personal guarantor can be filed before NCLT or before DRT.
Just as a follow-up, because for instance, if it's an individual or a partnership firm who's the debtor, only if it's a corporate guarantor can we proceed against the guarantor in that regard? Because I think
the corporate guarantor is not covered under this process. Like I would say, the definition of personal guarantor, the definition of personal guarantor is provided in the rules. And it says the debtor who is a personal guarantor to a corporate debtor and in respect of whom guarantee has been invoked by the creditor and remains unpaid in full or part. So there is nothing like corporate guarantor in this case. So in case the guarantee has been provided by any person to any partnership firm or to any proprietorship firm against supply of goods, it is not applicable. The guarantee should be provided for a debt taken by a company or a incorporated LLP and is guaranteed by the individual as a personal guarantor. Then only the insolvency of the personal guarantor can be done.
Right. Understood. And someone, generally a lot of people have been asking if it's okay to share the PPTs after the presentation.
Yeah, that, we'll try to share that. Yeah.
All right. Thank you. It's a question from C. Ram Samaria from Mathura. What is the role of asset mortgaged against loan financed? That is, first bank will liquidate the same and then invoke personal and then proceed against personal guarantors. I don't know if it's clear.
No, this, the bank can actually take both the actions concurrently. Bank can proceed against sale of assets, as well as bank can also file the personal guarantee. Both can be done. Both can be done.
Could you please mute it? Yes, thank you. So we'll just proceed with the next set of questions. I would request if C. Anuj Goyalji would like to take up a few questions, or should I continue with them? Okay, I think we shall continue with them for the time being. It's a question by CA Naresh Munjal from Delhi. Whether promoters of corporate debtor with support of their known investors can avoid application of Section 29A by filing withdrawal application under Section 12A as one-time settlement with bank?
see, like the question has to be, first of all, whether the corporate debtor is MSME or not. Because see, in the, both the situations, the scenario will change. If the corporate debtor is MSME, then of course the promoters with the proposed investor can submit a resolution plan. But in case the corporate debtor is not MSME, then the promoters along with any proposed investor cannot file a resolution plan.
It's a question from CA Rajesh Kumar Goyal from New Delhi. Can a case from DRT be transferred to NCLT for corporate debtors?
So there is no, there is nothing which is filed in DRT for corporate debtors. If an application for insolvency of personal guarantors is filed to DRT, because that corporate debtor is not under insolvency, and later on the corporate debtor comes under insolvency, CIRP or the liquidation is started in the NCLT, then all those applications of personal guarantors to that corporate debtor, which is pending before DRT, would also be transferred to NCLT, the same bench.
Right. A lot of people are appreciating the session, so I'm just trying to skip my way to questions. What is the position of operational creditors when operational creditors, the operational debt is outstanding is higher than that of financial creditors?
So the operational creditors continues to be operational creditor, even if the operational creditors are higher than the financial creditors. If there are financial creditors in the company, the committee would be constituted only by the financial creditors. The operational creditors would see whether they have, they will get anything in case the company is liquidated. For example, the assets of the company is 100 crore and the debt of the financial creditor is only 80 crores. So the rest of the 20 crores is to be distributed to other creditors who have priority below the secured creditors. That would be unsecured creditor, the employees, the government authorities and the operational creditors. So then in that case, whatever is eligible to be distributed to operational creditors, they have to get that in full in case of this situation. All depends upon the assets of the company. If the assets of the company has been depleted and it is barely sufficient only for the secured creditors, then after that, all other kind of creditors will not get any amount because there is nothing available in the company to be distributed. So see, when we say that the operational creditors are not getting anything out of in the insolvency process, it is only because the assets are less than the liabilities. And it is only based on the assets that has to be allocated to the creditors. So there is a priority given in the law, the first secured creditor, workman, then, so this is the priority. Based on the priority, they would be entitled to their share.
Right. Another question from CA Sanjeev Singhal from Noida. Can MSMEs where a CIRP process has commenced go for pre-package insolvency resolution process?
Anywhere where the CIRP process has already started, no PIRP can be started now unless the CIRP is withdrawn.
Another question by CA Ramakant Rao Golaji from Hyderabad. What if the financial creditor declines the request for or the declaration for going for PPIRP? What is the way ahead for the corporate debtor?
So like after the declaration by majority of directors, the company will engage with the creditors to accept the resolution plan, waste resolution plan, and provide me the in principle approval. The creditors will negotiate, and in case they are not convinced, they would say that, no, we are not convinced. It is the duty of the company to convince them that in case they will not accept, then somebody will file CIRP. or the SARFAESI action will start, the company will be closed, the value will be diminished. But still, in case they don't accept that, the base resolution plan can be modified so that it is acceptable to them. Still, if it is not possible to be accepted by the financial creditors, then the company keeps running the way it was running. Then the promoters may think of other options like CIRP or may adding a partner or bringing an investor. So this is a continuous process. If one process is not successful, the other process will start. If the other process is not successful, the third will start. So the only thing is that once the banks accept and once the PIRP is declared by the NCLT, thereafter, the second process cannot be started within 3 years. So whereas the first process of 90 days, which is the process with the banks, that's a continuous process till the time the banks accept in principle approval. That can start every 90 days, that can start any time, any number of times.
The appointed RP is removed. When the RP or new RP is appointed, what is the locus standi of the existing senior officials?
So in PIRP, I think the question is restricted to PPIRP only, because there are two different questions, there are two different answers, one for the PIRP and one for the CIRP. I think we will take up it as the PIRP. So the question is that RP can be changed by the Committee of Creditors. There is no doubt, because Section 27 is applicable to PPIRP also. The Committee of Creditors can change the RP and appoint somebody else. As far as the change of the RP is concerned, there is no difference to the key managerial personals. The key managerial personals are with the company and they would continue to be with the company. So there is no change in their status or their terms and conditions of working. RP change does not impact them.
Right. A few questions have been taken up earlier and they're on a similar line. This is a question by CA Ajay Gulati ji from Delhi. In a case where assets are more than liabilities, you said perhaps a PIRP is not feasible, but if in such a case where there is financial stress which can be resolved by providing additional funding, whether in that case PIRP shall be feasible?
So like in case the assets are more than the liabilities, then there is a different kind of restructuring that would be required. That means that the default is present default is only because of the mismatch of cash flow. And that is also called a default. So those kind of cases also can be resolved through PPIRP, although there is more, the assets are higher. So in all these cases, we will not be asking for any kind of haircut. Rather, we would be asking for deferment. We would be asking for moratorium. We would be asking for some kind of time that is required to monetize the assets of the company. That would be the resolution plan rather than asking for the haircut. It is very well doable, and that's an appropriate thing to do under PPIRP. If there are assets, but it is difficult to monetize those assets and there is a mismatch of fund flow. Very correct question. And so thank you very much for this question. This actually provides clarity what exactly the insolvency resolution is. Insolvency resolution doesn't mean always that the assets are less than the liabilities.
Indeed. Just a last question from amongst the questions that you received. Whether a registered society can go to NCLT?
So the societies, there are two kinds of societies in our country. One is an incorporated entity and the other is the unincorporated entity. I think the registered societies, where the registrar of firms or the registrar of societies doing some registration of societies, those are not incorporated. But there are societies where in the last, there is a word called limited is written. There are some societies where the limited word is also mentioned. So those are incorporated entities. So every incorporated entity May it be a society, may it be a partnership firm, which is LLP, or which is the or a company, can definitely be under CIRP or PIRP.
Right. Would it be okay if I ask a question? I had a question of my own.
Certainly.
All right.
Moderator can ask 10 questions.
Just one question. So considering that a contract of guarantee is a tripartite contract, and generally after a CIRP process, what is the status of the right of subrogation of the guarantor vis-a-vis the corporate debtor?
So you see, very good question from my advocate Aman Goyal. In a resolution plan, normally the company is taken away by an RA, and the banks are proceeding against the personal guarantors or the corporate guarantors. As per the Indian Contract Act, if any amount is paid by a guarantor, the guarantor falls into the shoes of the creditor. So he has all the rights to recover that money from the corporate debtor. So therefore, in a resolution plan, it is very carefully mentioned that the guarantors would not have any right of subrogation on the corporate debtor. And that is approved by the committee of creditors and finally the adjudicating authority. And that actually would protect the company from any kind of claim from the personal guarantor or from the corporate debtor, from the corporate guarantors. So this is very clearly mentioned in the resolution plan that this right is would not have. They would not have that right. And that is binding. So in case we see the section 31, the resolution plans are binding on the guarantors also. So whatever is approved, that will be binding.
But just a small follow-up, would that be enough to override a statutory provision under the Contracts Act?
Yes, because the resolution plan is binding on the guarantors. So therefore, the resolution plan, which is approved, says that they would not have any right of subrogation on the creditor, and they would not have any recourse on the corporate debtor. That would be binding on them. So they would not have any entitlement to recover from the corporate debtor.
All right. Thank you for that answer. I would request the Anuj Goyalji for his closing remarks.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I think there are two devices. One device that you have to log out. Then only the eco would.
Thank you, Aman Goyalji, and thank you, C. Anil Goyalji. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
So I'm really grateful to C. Anil Goyalji for this wonderful deliberation. We kept it for 3 hours. 3 hours was, of course, normally we do keep only for 2 hours our own VCMs. So keeping the thing in mind that Anil Goyalji and our past president Subodh Agrawalji is having an ocean of knowledge, we kept it for 3 hours. We have already crossed 3 hours, 14 minutes. And more than 3,500 chartered accountants have joined today's virtual CP program. That shows our interest, our keen interest in the insolvency and bankruptcy. And let me tell you, the best accounting professionals across the globe, the chartered accountants, are best suited for the insolvency and bankruptcy code practice. And it would be not only good for themselves, but also will be good for the trade and industry, and will be really good for the economy as a whole. And I'm quite confident after the deliberation of C. Anil Goyalji and our past president, Subodh Agrawalji, we were having, of course, the presence of our chairman of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Committee, I'm quite confident after the deliberation of all the dignitaries, we will certainly be benefited out of that, and it will go a long way. We'll look forward to have more and more programs. I'm grateful to Aman Goyalji for moderating and the program, Dr. Amit Agrawalji, our secretary of CCMIP, C. Amit Agrawalji, secretary in the secretariat of the research committee, Kunal Sharma ji, and all our honorable viewers from each and every part of the country. I think more than 3,000 chartered accountants have attended. So I'm really, really grateful to all of you for making this session very, very effective. And I'm quite confident that you all must be taking very, very good care of yourself and your family members in this time of corona pandemic. And we'll request all of you once again to get yourself vaccinated along with your family members so that we can very effectively fight from this pandemic, corona. So thank you very much, friends. Have a good day. Happy learning. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anuj Bhai, and thank you, Advocate Aman, for such a nice moderation that you have done. And this actually looks very amazing that at such a age that you have developed that kind of understanding of the questions, because I was actually pleased to see that you have an understanding about the questions. So Anuj Bhai, thank you very much for this opportunity, and my greetings to also Mr. Durgesh Kabra and my fellow speaker, Mr. Subodh Agarwal. Thank you very much. I enjoyed, and I always say that this is my way of learning. Thank you.
So thank you, Anil Goyal ji. Thank you very much. Thank you, Aman. Thank you, all our honorable viewers from each and every part of the country, rather outside country also. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good day.
Thank you. You all.
Recording stopped.